Hi! I recently bought a new, or better, used synthesizer, and I'm really excited to make some music with it. It's a Roland MKS-70, an analog polysynth from 1986. It has two digital oscillators, analog filter, and 12 voice. It was a very professionally expensive machine when it came out, and it ended up being used in a lot of very famous records. Think about the soundtrack of Twin Peaks or the riff of Final Countdown by Europe. How cool is that? I always wanted one of those since it can make really nice sounds and I just think it looks really pretty. But after playing with it a bit though, I found an issue with it. The preset sounds are good and they're easy to select, but it's missing the cool part of being a synthesizer. Editing the sounds in real time is, in fact, not very feasible. You have to navigate to complicated menus and enter the number of the parameter that you want to change and then use a rotary encoder on the front to change the value. You can imagine how that's not very convenient, especially since there are more than 80 parameters that you can change, like the PCF frequency or the volume. Other than a film musician and synthesizer enthusiast, I'm also a software engineer by trade. So I wondered, is there any way I can improve this instrument using technology from today, making it more useful, more usable, and allowing more creative expression with it? And ideally, I would want to control it with computer software so that I don't have to navigate through the menus. I can just use my laptop. The first step towards this goal, though, it's understanding how it works. Let's disassemble it and let's look at how it works inside. There are a bunch of screws to remove, but after that's done, the top panel comes right off, exposing a lot of complicated printed circuit boards and a lot of different cables. And here it is, the MKS-70 in all its naked glory. To understand what we are looking at though, we need some schematics. And thankfully, the synthesizer service manual that was used to repair it, it's still available online. And with it, we can understand a lot of things about its inner workings. The core of this synthesizer, it's made up by pretty much three printed circuit boards. Two voice boards, which are hinged, which is pretty cool, I think. And one assigner board that is on here. The voice boards are responsible for actually producing sounds. In fact, they contain the DCOs, the filters, the amplifiers, that they also contain their own CPU. And instead, the assigner board, it's the board that is responsible for handling MIDI communication, MIDI input, and handling the front panel. Basically, the notes arrive through MIDI input. They get processed by the assigner board, and the two voice boards are the one that actually synthesize the sound. So let's try to understand in detail how the voice boards work. They're based around an Intel 8031 processor, which is actually a very common microcontroller. And it's communicating with the assigner board through two digital lines, one called assign signal, and another one called interrupt. Just two wires are apparently shared between the two voice ports, so I guess that there must be some sort of select command to select which ports we want to talk to. Since the assigner signal pin connects directly to the RXD pin of the 8031 processor, we can assume that it's using UART, which is a very common serial interface used by many microcontrollers, and it's actually the same one that MIDI uses internally. When requested to play notes, the CPU in the voice ports produces a lot of analog voltages, and it's doing that by using a very simple digital analog converter built using a resistor ladder, and then dispatches those voltages around the rest of the board using a bunch of 4051 multiplexers. Multiplexers are actually a very cool integrated circuit because they are basically switches and they allow you to drive or receive multiple analog signals using a single ADC or DAC. In this synthesizer, the oscillators are digitally controlled. Since it's difficult to create analog oscillators that stay in tune, Roland solved this problem by using digital control. An 8 MHz signal that is generated in the oscillator board is divided into lower frequencies into the audio range by using those ICs, which are Intel 8254 counters. Each clock cycle on the 5 MHz signal makes the counter IC increase its internal value, and when it reaches a programmable value, it strobes one of its pins so that it can generate a saw wave. The saw wave is generated using capacitors, which are discharged using the clock signals that is divided by the counter ICs. This way, we can generate waveforms which are analogically generated, but still, since they use a digital clock, they never go out of tune, pretty much. For each one of the six voices, the output from the two digital oscillators, it's then processed using this custom Roland IC called IR3RO5, which is a chip that contains a PCA, an amplifier, and a filter in a single chip. So this is a quick overview of the voice boards, which are in charge of generating those sounds that this synthesizer can make. The assigner board, though, the one that is down here, it's a bit more boring because it's pretty much entirely digitally controlled and it creates no sound on its own. I'm actually not interested in using the synthesizer from its front panel. I want to control it from my laptop, honestly. I don't want to touch it while it's on my rack. And so I guess we can bypass this board here and simulate its behavior using software. But to do so, we first need to understand which commands, which signals it's transmitting to the two voice boards. And we can do that by using a cheap logic analyzer, which is a device that it's used to record and then analyze digital signals. We can connect one line of the logic analyzer to the ground that is readily available here in the test pin, and the other two lines, one to the assigner signal of the voice board and the other one to the interrupt signals that is coming into the voice board. This way we can monitor what is happening between those two boards and maybe recreate it using software. I'm using the open source software PulseView to record what is happening in those digital lines when performing different tasks, such as turning on the synthesizer, changing some parameters, or playing some notes. By doing this, we can hopefully understand what is being transmitted during those operations, to then be able to maybe emulate it in software. And since we know that the assigner signal pin, it's using probably a UART signal, we can use a PulseView decoder plugin to decode its corresponding byte values. And let's look at what we find with this. If we look at the beginning of the signal, we can see how there are a lot of F9 bytes that are being transmitted, followed by the interrupt line being triggered once. This happens a second time after sending a bunch of F1s, and after that, the interrupt line never goes down again. Using this information, we can suppose that this is some sort of initialization procedure used to wait for the voice boards to be ready. We can also imagine that since the serial line is shared between the two voice boards, the F1 and F9 commands are being used to select to which voice board we want to communicate with. Let's look at what happens instead when a note is being triggered by MIDI. We can divide this message in two parts. The first part starts with an F9 byte, which, as we supposed before, is selecting one of the two voice boards. After that, we have a C0, which is probably a note on command, followed by 3C, which is the MIDI code for the note that we pressed, and a 47, which is the velocity for the key that we pressed. The second message is pretty much the same, just that it starts with an F1 byte, which probably means that it's then selecting the other board to play the note with the other board as well. When we play multiple notes at the same time, we can also figure out another interesting information about this protocol, and it's that the second nibble in the C0 command represents which one of the six voices we want to play. For example, C0 plays a note with the first voice, C1 plays a note with the second voice, and so on. Hopefully, with this information, we can already try to send some note-on signals to this board and see if some notes are playing. We continue the reverse engineering process to figure out the rest of the protocol. For example, the notes off command works like a note-on, but it just used the D0 command instead of C0. The synth parameters can be changed by sending first a parameter ID followed by the value that we want. And the parameters ID, it's a thing that is already known because it's the same one for the PG800 programmer. The stuff like the control changes, such as sustain, modulation, and bender, use their own custom ID. And also a special parameter ID, it's used to control the master tune for the two boards. At this point, probably we already have enough information to code our own software that sends signals to those two boards and completely bypass the assigner board so that we can use it with our DAW, with our digital audio workstation instead. But first of all, we need to create some hardware that can communicate with the two voice boards. Thankfully, UART USB boards are very available and they are pretty much dirt cheap. I picked up this one at a local electronics store for around 2 euros. And to make it more convenient to use, I desoldered its USB connector and wired up a micro USB connector to the front panel, and I did it here in place of the programmer cable. We connect the ground pin of the USB to UART interface to a pin that is now available on the power supply, and we instead connect the transmit pin of the UART to USB converter to the two voice ports by carefully removing the pin from the connectors and by creating a custom adapter that I soldered together by using some pin headers. Once everything was wired up, I tried to send some bytes to the voice boards to play some notes using my computer, but unfortunately nothing happened. And the reason for that is that that specific UART to USB converter wasn't able out of the box to produce the 31,250 baud rate that is the one that these boards use. So I had to investigate a bit, but then I found that there is an utility from the manufacturer that allows you to customize the baud rate. And after I changed that, I tried to do the same thing again, and magically the synthesizer played a note, which was really exciting, honestly. So I started coding to write the real software that we want to use, and I wrote a bunch of C++ line of code, and you can find them in my GitHub profile down in the description. The program that I built creates a virtual MIDI port, which appears in software like Logic as an external MIDI device. So you can create a new track in Logic and directly route it to the MKS-70. And I managed to do this using an open source library called Port MIDI, which allows you doing a lot of very cool MIDI stuff, including virtual MIDI ports. And this was only a few lines of code, so that was cool. The program that I wrote listens to the new MIDI events that are coming from Logic or from your DAW, and it converts those commands into commands that the voice ports can understand. And then it sends them, sends the bytes using the serial device that we just wrote. And by using this, the voice ports are able to play some notes directly from your DAW without going through MIDI at all. Since we need to keep track of the voices and we need to select which one of the six voices we want to use. We need to keep track of which notes are playing and which ones are free. And by using this method, we can also build some cool algorithms on top of it. For example, I implemented a voice stealing algorithm, which removes the old notes when you play new ones and you finished up your polyphony. And it also supports unison, poly, monomode, whole and dual mode, so that you can play two sounds at the same time. And I also found out that if you dispatch each voice to one of the two voice boards, it creates a fatter and thicker and stereo wider sound, simply because the two boards have a different clock, so that this makes the synthesizer probably even sound better. Then, since we also want to change the parameters of the sounds as we are playing in real time, I updated the user interface using the IMGUI library, which lays down all the synthesizer parameters as sliders. And this way I can easily change all the parameters in real time by just clicking and dragging them. And this also bypasses the internal structure that the synthesizer has with patches and tones, so it makes everything simpler to program. This is probably not the same thing as using an hardware programmer, but I guess that it's already much, much better than using the user interface that the front panel provides. I also implemented a button to select and import system exclusive files so that you can play sounds that are already available. So, let's listen to what this synthesizer can do then. So I hope that this is a thing that can make the synthesizer more easy, more enjoyable to use, especially in a studio setting. Especially because the real cool thing about having a hardware synthesizer is being able to make your own sounds. And this way it's easier, I think. And I think that we can improve it even more by adding an hardware programmer. Unfortunately, the original programmer, the PG-800, it's nowadays very difficult to find. And the alternatives that you can still buy online are also very expensive. But I think there might be an alternative to that. But for that, I will need to wait for some PCBs to arrive in my mailbox. So stay tuned for part 2, in which we will build together a new hardware programmer for the MKS-70 and DJ Exit P. And so far, thank you for watching.